give me just a minute to catch my breath. Thank you. Okay. The Lord's name is to be praised. That means when the sun rises until the sun sets, the Lord's name is to be praised. And how do we praise him? With our mouth, with the life that we live. Do you give praise to honor and glory to the Lord continually? That's what he desires, and that is what he is so worthy of. This is a little course that the pastor and I learned when we went to the Cove one time. And we've sung it here before, but it's been a while. So if you're not comfortable with it, we're going to do it till you are.
Thank you. bring the house lights up for me, Lori. And by the way, I'll show a video right before I preach. I'll introduce it, and right before I preach, I want to show it because it'll tie in with the message. Just a brief political now. Now, I had told her I was going to throw a curveball this morning. I got a video I want to show. I haven't shown it in about two years, but it's really a good one. It ties right in with the message. She said, "Where are you going to put it?" I said, "I don't know. I'll let you know." So, but it's good to be in God's house. Amen?
Amen.
We've had church already. That's what we're here for, to praise and worship Him. I'm going to finish up my series on Haggai today. We're going to look at consider your faith. We've looked at consider your actions, consider your Lord, consider your ways. Today we're going to look at consider your faith. We'll finish it up. Got a movie this afternoon at 2 p.m. Now, we got a lot to do, and I'm going to get us out as early as I can, but I ain't going to rush anything. Amen? And because if we don't get started at 2:30, we'll get started. But we're going to watch this movie this afternoon. How many of you have seen Faith Like Potatoes? All right, have you got the trailer ready? Show the trailer one more time. Y'all need to stay. Everybody here needs to stay for this movie at 2 o'clock. If you want to go eat, go eat. But we're going to have hot dogs, so just stay around. And Kim said, and popcorn. And chips.
The violence has continued unabated. Vigilante factions have taken law into their own hands.
With his homeland left behind in the turmoil of political unrest, one man must take his family and start a new life.
Welcome to our new home.
We're like gypsies now, gypsies in the Garden of Eden.
Now, his strength will be challenged.
Why don't you plant potatoes?
We don't have the water. It's a disaster. The worst drought in years.
His courage will be tested.
It feels like I'm getting nowhere. I'm trying my best, but it's just work, work, work.
And his faith will be transformed.
I made a decision yesterday to give my whole life, my family, and my farm to Jesus.
Something's changed in my heart. And I've seen some miracles.
When God's creation's broken, He's more than able to fix it.
This year, we're gonna plant potatoes!
Plant potatoes now, they're gonna die, and that's it.
I don't do this, Lord.
Experience the triumph of a farmer whose faith made him a phenomenon.
Well, we're going to get some hot dogs from somewhere. Amen. Okay. All right. So that'll be this afternoon at 2 o'clock. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. It's good to have I Am Outreach Ministry with us. Brother Brent, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Father, we lift you up and we thank you for the doors opening up this morning. We thank you for the people that are here, the sound of the preachers and the songs that have been sang some this morning for you, Lord. Lord, may the faith stirred up inside of us, Lord, yes. Bring fruit of righteousness and bring yes. fruit, God, that glorifies your name. Yes. And we thank you so much for what you do for us, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Sing, choir.
Yeah.
She
said, so many, you know, haven't come back from COVID, and it's just a small choir. I says, well, sometimes we might have 10, sometimes we might have 12, sometimes we might have 5 or 7, but we still have our choir. And I said, I would put them against a choir of hundreds or thousands because this is our ministry. It doesn't matter if there's 3 of us or 30 of us. This is our ministry.
That's right.
And we're not singing to impress anybody. We're vessels for the Holy Spirit to use to minister to your hearts and to minister to our hearts. So we meet here at 9 o'clock on Sunday morning just to go over our songs. And that is what just gives me my B12 shot. It just energizes me. And Wednesday nights when they practice, it just fills my heart to overflowing. So may we never get to the part where we no longer have our choir, because they minister greatly.
And because you do it for the right reason.
Exactly. And that's
because
what
you
I
do
told
it
her.
For the
heart.
Yes.
And because you do it for the right reason, God puts it all together.
I said, sometimes we might not be on key. Sometimes we might be who knows what key. But the Lord just, he just blends it and puts it all together for his honor and his glory. And that's what we're here for. So I've mentioned it before, but if you have a longing to serve the Lord through song, Wednesday nights after service, we have choir practice. So please, you pray about it and then you be obedient to how the Lord leads you. And also we want to say thank you to the sound room.
Yep.
I have to keep them straight every once in a while. But you know, that's their ministry. So I'm so thankful for what the Lord has brought together and what he uses here.
She won't let me sing, though.
I don't care if you sing. We're just not going to give you a mic.
She said, you sing, you're like you're in jail, a few bars behind in the wrong key.
I'll bring me a basket. I dare you to carry his.
Are you glad to be at Tabernacle this morning? Stand up, turn around, shake hands with somebody. Let them know you're glad to see them.
Thank you.
be having fellowship. Don't start a relationship. That's good. Thank you. You may find your seats. We got a lot of stuff to do. Praise God, when they get to heaven, they'll fellowship all the time. General quarters. Huh? Okay. All right. After I get them to settle down. You don't have general quarters?
Ron, you have to give them a mic.
Huh? I will. I'll give him a mic. There you go. Thanks, Kurt. All right. Got a couple of things we want to do. Cecil?
Hello. There's something I pray for every day for everybody in this church, and I pray especially for our pastor and his wife, that they be filled with the Holy Spirit every time they stand in front of us. And then I pray for people out in the congregation. I say, Lord, fill everybody with the Holy Spirit. You know, it's good when God answers prayer, ain't it?
Amen. Yes, it is.
He has done something here this morning already,
yeah.
And he ain't done yet. This service, I already feel it, I already know it. This service is going to be an awesome, awesome service because we have said, fill us with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Do it now. Fill us with
the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Fill us with the Holy Spirit, Lord. Don't just stop. Don't just stop with him. Don't stop with her. Although I pray for them every day, and before I come to church on Sunday morning, I say, fill them. And boy, have they filled them this morning.
Amen.
Amen. I really do. So sit back, stand up, dance, shout, whatever you feel like do it this morning because God's in control and the Holy Spirit says so.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, people. I appreciate it. Where's Cindy Black at? There she is. Come here. I want her to share something with you that we experienced this week on Wednesday, and I'll let her tell you in her own words.
So
hold it up to your mouth.
This like that, yeah. So my grandma is 92. She's supposed to be 93. She makes it to March, and I know some of y'all don't know. She's got Alzheimer's, and she's really gone downhill very quickly. We did finally get hospice in and everything. And my dad has been expressing for about 2 months that he wishes to be baptized. I'm not sure where that came from. I've never heard him say anything about it, but for the last couple months, he's been really thinking about it. And so I asked the preacher, because he's not very mobile, could he come here and just like get water over his head? But then I asked the preacher the other day, I said, if I give you gas money, will you please come to Benson and pray over my grandma and go ahead and baptize my daddy? And he said, no. You can't give me gas money. I got it. Yeah, he didn't say no to the baptism. And then, so he came over Wednesday, and he talked to my daddy for quite some time. And it was funny because my stepmom was in the kitchen. She was like, this is a really private talk. I feel like, maybe we need to go here. I said, no, you need to hear what he's saying, too. And all week, I had been led to take my Bible and my notebook and journal and stuff and talk to them as much as I can because I've only been a Christian for like almost 15 years. So I still consider myself a new Christian. So I talk to them as much as I can with what I know. And my daddy had started asking questions and stuff, so we would find out. And so while he was praying with my daddy, saying the sinner's prayer, I noticed that in between the kitchen and the living room, there's a big arch. And my stepmom was there. She had her head down. So I thought she was just like listening to what preacher had to say, praying stuff. And but when we got through and he was ready to do my daddy, with the bucket. Mm-hmm. I gave him a bucket to dunk his head in. He was like, no, Cindy, we have to pour it over there. So anyway, we fixed that. So I'm sorry, I had never done that before. So, learning curve. So I gave him the bucket and everything. He did my daddy. But before he did that, my stepmom said, I said that prayer too. And I just was like, what? And because she and I had not discussed anything about her
saved or baptized or anything like that, but she did. And he was like, that's great. You know, have you been baptized? And she's like, oh, yeah, a couple of times. And he said, well, if you're taking salvation now, you really need to be rebaptized because, you know, maybe it didn't take her first time.
I told her she just got wet the first time.
And right, she right. That's what he said. And so I'm paraphrasing.
Okay.
And so anyway, she came in, and after he did Daddy, she sat down on the couch, and he did her. And I'm going to tell you what, my heart was overflowing. I don't think I stopped smiling for 2 or 3 days. Mm-hmm. I had kind of walked away from work for a few seconds to do all of this, and I didn't walk out, but I'll ask for forgiveness later. When I got back online, the first thing I did was told everybody in my chat group, guess what just happened? Because it overflowed, and I just felt like it was spilling out, and I was ecstatic. And so now, every day, they're like, how's the preacher? And, you know, tell them we said thank you. And I just want to let you know, my daddy said that he's going to send you a card, and it's going to have 20 bucks in it. and I told him, I said, Daddy, the preacher said, don't worry about it. He said, well, I'm going to do it. And I said, well, he's not going to take it. He said, well, if it's in a card, he can't give it back. I said, well, you can give it to me and tell me to give it to you, and then you'll never see it. He would never know.
Amen. Now, let me tell you, Ray, whenever I got there and I started talking to him, I've always been the type of person that I don't try to browbeat anybody into salvation, but I try to find something in common with them. And so I started talking to him, and I said, you know, I was raised on a farm. He said, me too. I said, you remember pulling sand lugs? He said, boy, do I. Well, we started talking about farming, and we talked probably about 30, 45 minutes. And then I finally got around and asked him, I said, Ray, your mother in there knows, she's firmly convinced, and she knows that she's going to heaven. What about you? He said, I don't know. I said, you're not saved? He said, no. Took him through the plan of salvation. He started praying the sinner's prayer. He could not hardly get through it. He was weeping like a baby. I mean, just crying. Just crying. And they're physically not able to be dunked under the water. So I said, well, here, you know, nothing against Methodists, but I'm not a Methodist, and I ain't going to pray for you. But I think you got to cover your head with water. I'll tell you a joke about that in a minute. But anyhow, I said, go get me. She went and got me a big old bucket. She filled it full of water, tub. And I said, no, get me a bowl of water, a big bowl of water. So she did. She got me a bowl of water about that big around, about that high. And I had him put the bucket in his lap, lean his head over, and I poured that whole bowl of water over him. Then I got one for her. So we got baptized, all right? Amen. The reason I say that about sprinkling, a good friend of mine up here at Pierce Baptist Church used to be, when he was up there, Gordon Hood. He was a Methodist minister, and he went into retirement, and he was going to Baptist Church up here. And he and I became very good friends. Matter of fact, he got me back in when I was trying to get out. But anyhow, we would argue sometimes, fun stuff about it. I said, you know, got to be immersed to be really baptized and everything like that. I said, he said, and I thought about this when I was doing the baptizing the other day. He said, no, all you got to do is sprinkle the top of the head. I said, no, you got to be immersed. He said, if you get knee-deep in the water, are you baptized? I said, no. And he said, if you get waist-deep in the water, are you baptized? I said, no. If you get up to your neck, are you baptized? I said, no. He said, what about if you get it over your head? I said, yeah. He said, I told you it was all about the head. Amen. Let's take up the children's offering. Let me have all the kids 12 and under. As you hold up a dollar bill or whatever, five, make sure you're smiling, because we're trying to teach them there's joy in giving back to the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you for these children. Let us help them, Lord, to teach them the joy of giving back to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. goes into the children's ministry. So it's thank you for helping them out. All right, let's have our ushers come receive the regular offering. We ask you to give as God directs you, because God loves what kind of giver?
Cheerful.
Cheerful. Very, very cheerful. Amen. Now bless the blessing, please, sir.
Heavenly Father, O gracious Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be in your house. We ask that you bless each and every one that is here today. Bless this offering, Lord, multiply it, only you can do. We thank you for all that you do, all the blessings that you bestow upon. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Remember a while back at Revival, Brother Steve drove home the idea that if it ain't personal, it ain't powerful. Well, this is personal. You know, we're all going to go through things that are going to hurt. Some really hurt a lot. You know, the loss of someone we love hurts really bad. But there is comfort when that loved one is saved, because we know we're going to see him again. But sometimes in life, things come from not just out of left field, but from outer space. And they totally knock the wind out your sails. And when they do, all we can do is turn to the one that is all powerful. And his comfort and his grace and his love and his mercy will walk us through everything. He's promised he's not going to leave us. He's with us. We reach out for him. I've experienced something like that not too terribly long ago. And it hurt me so bad. For several weeks, I was not me. I couldn't talk about it. Couldn't barely think about it. I couldn't hardly do my job at work. I had so many invoices come back during a two-week period because I made all these math mistakes and gave people the wrong things. But my boss was graceful. He knew what I was dealing with and what I was going through and why I was hurting. But I knew that I had to come out of it. I knew God would bring me out of it. And one of the things he's given me that helps me cope and worship is music. I love music. And sometimes some songs just really move me and they touch me and they encourage me and lift me up. And I wanted to use that to feel better, to move forward. And I was hurting really bad. And God got with me. I was just by myself at the house. And he got with me. And he said, dry your eyes. Put your hands on the keys. Just sing from your heart. And listen to me. This is called Singing in the Valley. And I hope that it'll be a blessing to you. Gas pedal's on the right, clutch is on the left. Okay. All right. That was my first track. All right, here we go. All right, third time's the charm. Here we go, y'all. down at this old piano. And I am broke today. So I bang a chord. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen. Good job, Eric.